Hello, hello everybody, and welcome to another episode of Age of Wonders Shadow Magic. This footage I recorded initially and I talked through the entire thing, but I later found out that I in fact forgot to turn on my microphone. So here we are, me having to narrate this a little bit later. I hope I remember everything I did and what I was thinking about at the time, but we'll see how it goes. This will be a bit of a longer episode today. You got lucky, I suppose. I just wasn't paying attention and I was all of a sudden recording for 45 minutes. So yeah, long episode today. I am a bit sick, unfortunately, so if you hear me mute my mic for no apparent reason, it's probably because I'm coughing my lungs out, but we'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes today. The general thing I'm doing this episode is building up my economy and my army for the impending assault on our enemies. Yeah, first let's see what we've got here. This city here on the top, I generally don't develop too much, I think. Yeah, I do build a war hall here, just to give me some units other than the basic ones. This hero, I think I moved down, and I later on improved the army quality of that army. Okay, I move that unit to the watchtower to have a little bit of coverage in the area, so that when the mission comes of the quest of the spirit of magic, that I have some units everywhere that I can get to my quests quite quickly. I'm expecting a hunt for infidels, which is just a random army that spawns in your territory that you need to kill. Ah, oh man, the sniffles. You'll have to humor me a little bit today for this my sniffing and coughing. Ah. On the bright side, I did just complete my master thesis defense, and if I do say so myself, I nailed it. So yeah, things should slowly but steadily start returning to normal. Some more regular updates I think will happen now. Now here I actually get super lucky. My Spirit of Magic quest starts, and I find then that that it's somewhere in enemy territory, but for some reason my enemy decides to kill this army for me, and I immediately get a reward for my quest. Now at this point in time I didn't really realize this all too well. I thought I was just getting a reward for building a shrine of magic, but I do later on check it with I think it's a bone dragon that I send out. Yeah, here we go. There goes the bone dragon. And it moves out. Now one realization I did have... oh, excuse me. One realization I did have is that of all my opponents, there are two evil and one good. So in total there are three evil players and one good player in total. Which means that the amount of heroes that are currently out there are probably, for the majority, evil heroes. Now, I have not done this in this playthrough just yet, but yeah, in the episode I record after this, I will probably research Resurrect Hero. This means that all the heroes that were slain, which are probably the majority evil heroes, I can then recruit to my cause. And of course, having more heroes is a good thing. They're very powerful units, so why not use them? I decide to send this army upwards to try and harass this army that attacked our ally in the previous episode. Animate Hero, that's the one. That I don't research it right now. I go for Summoner's Aura, which is a useful spell, don't get me wrong. I'm definitely not regretting doing it, but I think the next course of research will definitely be Animate Hero. This is definitely my military city. It's nice and close to this arena, and as you probably noticed by now, I prefer a small, high-quality army over an enormous, shitty army. At least later on in the game, once I can start affording this. Now here I actually go looking for the infidels and find out that in fact the quest is already complete. So instead I go annoy my opponent a little bit. Scout out as well, this is also not a bad thing. These bone dragons are definitely not weak, so a random scout in the environment doesn't really threaten us too much. Now, I'm not sure which ability I picked here. I'm attack, magic attack and vision 1 I think I'm looking at here. I think I go for the flat out improvement on my attack. I always like these general stat boosts a lot more than upgrading abilities. And magic strike is something I already gave this hero because of an enchantment I used, so I think this was the correct choice. Now this city I'm definitely going to use or going to ask to produce merchandise. Oh no, apparently I want a more mobile army. Oh yeah, that makes sense. Okay, so I'm expecting every once in a while to get a request from the Spirit of Magic to kill something or whatever. And when this happens, I want to have armies spread around my my empire to be able to respond to this. They don't have to be huge, definitely at first, where the infidels and other random stuff he asks you to kill are not that powerful yet. Yeah, this will definitely help. You can see here this strange blue snow. I think this is actually a graphics bug rather than an actual game texture. I'm not really sure why these graphic glitches are happening. In my previous Let's Play, this was before I reinstalled my computer, but I was perfectly able to record this without doing anything fancy. But I definitely have to do some funny stuff in order to get this to record. If I just set the resolution to 720p, I can't get this to record or record a black screen. If I set it to 1080, this is no longer possible. I can't do this. So 720 is the maximum I can record. I mean, it's an old game, so it makes sense, but I have to tune down my my screen resolution on my computer to 720p. Then I need to play it in windowed mode, and then I can record this game at 720p. It's a bit of a hassle each time I need to do this, but I do rather enjoy playing this game. And judging by the views I'm getting, you're also enjoying watching it, so I'm definitely going to continue doing it. Yeah, it's a little bit strange that I'm having so much trouble. Also, since that I've had to do this funny stuff, I'm also having trouble with record or with these texture glitches in the environment. We'll see how this playthrough goes. Maybe I'll try and improve this a little more later, but I don't have a lot of hope, to be honest. I'm also not sure what's causing it, which is, yeah, unfortunate. Now here I spot my an enemy army and I decide to get my bone dragon to safety. I mean, it's just one bone dragon, but it is one of the more powerful units in my arsenal, and right now I can't really miss my my powerful units. There are a fair few armies already at the top there, and yeah, sooner rather than later I'm going to find out that there's in fact a great deal more army hiding in the shadows. That sounds like a music video of some sort, hiding in the shadows, some heavy metal rock band. Probably is. Ooh, that looks weird. Okay, so I start beefing up this army here in the watchtower. This is going to be my second main army. The cities down there, I'm going to keep the Dark Elves. The actual units they produce are not that good, besides their archers. Their shade is also quite nice. But yeah, there's a limited amount of units that are actually quite useful from the Dark Elves. But their racial... each race has a different bonus they give to your city. So the Shadow Demons, I think it's production. They produce units a great deal quicker. But for the Dark Elves, it's mana income. They give you plus 20 mana income, I think, per city, which is quite a lot. And considering I have a fair few summoned units, which I have a quite large upkeep, I think this is a good idea for me to employ a larger amount of these Dark Elf cities. And I think the bottom left is the ideal place to do so. Excuse me. I decide to scout a little bit further, see what I can see. Not too much towards my opponent. I don't actually want to lose my flying unit, so... Oh. Oh, man. Why did I decide to do this voiceover of 45 minutes when I'm sick? Anyway, I'll have to suffer through now. Production is going quite nicely in the newly built cities. They're also getting to a point where I can really start using them. So the investment we made earlier on to build these cities, at first, of course, this takes a lot of money because you you have to pay upkeep for these cities, start building buildings there, and you also need a few units to defend it. Not necessarily against our opponent, but definitely these random armies that, for instance, the Spirit of Magic spawns, but also other other armies can randomly spawn in, particularly if you start killing off cities, which is a possibility. But if my ally, for instance, raises a city, the wandering army that then you get as a result will will start randomly killing stuff, and those can wander off to my cities. I don't really want to worry about this too much. Maybe later on, if I've got a few armies randomly scattered about in my my empire for the Spirit of Magic quests, or whatever else spirits we end up worshipping, then we might be able to reduce the amount of garrison army. It's already not very much, so yeah. But anyway, now these cities are developing, they're starting to generate income, and they've also now got the infrastructure to start building decent units. And very soon we are going to start producing these units at a very large rate. Here I take the air temple, or the air node, sorry. I do this primarily to, first of all, guard the city. I want to keep an eye on what's going on. And this will allow me to do so. It will give me a little bit... the CPU will probably go for that first before it moves out any further. And I'm also going to use it as a defensive position. Not that it will do much, but it's a nice venture, a nice point to keep an eye on that city there. Should also keep those armies tied down and keep them from attacking our ally any further. Here, I'm very happy. A Black Angel research. I don't know if you spotted it, but I just clicked the research for Dark Angel, which is the most powerful summon we have access to as a death specialist. Those of you that have not seen my last Let's Play might not be familiar with it. But the death specialist most powerful summon is Dark Angel, or Black Angel, or what are they called? Not sure. Anyway, they're very powerful, and I'm definitely going to use them. When I saw this, I really thought that I saw a little heap of gold laying there, but as it turns out, that was a lie. I'm going to take that Orc City you see there in the fog, and then afterwards I can convert that again to the Dark Elves. I'm sure they're very happy about this, the Orcs that are living there. That they're all getting shipped off and removed, and let's call it removed, and replaced with the Dark Elves. Sure they're happy about it. There we go. Now here I basically protect that area for the time being. Keep an eye on the armies there. I'm quite certain that if they decide to attack me, I'm able to kill them. Checking out the equipment his heroes have. Could be very useful to know this. Here I'm wondering whether or not I should keep that army down, and I decide that it's more important to defend my bottleneck city there. It's unlikely that they're just going to beeline straight to that city, and that I missed it somehow. I have a quite decent intelligence network set up. By that I mean this forward army near the Orc city. But it's definitely something we need to be careful with, because it's basically the doorway to my empire. Build another harvester, very useful unit. Don't know if I mentioned it in the last episode, so let me do it now. If I did, then you're going to hear it twice. But these harvesters are actually very useful units. They have a quite decent stats, but the most useful part about them is that once they kill a unit, they swallow it, and the next turn you can then spawn lava, which is our most basic unit we can make. These lava, if they ever reach the gold rank, they then transform into either a bombard or a spawn, which is our second tier units, I suppose you could call it. But yeah, the most useful part about it is you can then spawn this horde of units if you have a decently upgraded harvester. Yeah, that's the word. It's especially useful against against large hordes of shit units. So these large armies we've seen from our opponents so far primarily consists out of let's call them tier 2 units, the ones you get from the barracks. Also even tier 1, so the most basic units. I mean, in large quantities these can be dangerous, but if you've got a few harvesters in your army, they can then just eat a few of these units each turn and then poop out these basic units, which are a decent counter against these large shit armies, let's call them that. Here I contemplate buying the Wizard Tower instead of just waiting. I think I actually, I wait for it. I think sacrificing the gold and stuff, it's not really beneficial to improve this or improve the production speed for 2 turns. Oh, here I'm under attack, and here I do a quick battle, which surprises me intensely. This dragon actually survives. He kills off all their ranged units, and then the enemy retreats, which I found hilarious. So this dragon is now my best friend, and I decide to get it back to safety. That's the hero dragon. Let's see if we can keep him alive a little bit. Yeah, here I'm trying to figure out how it is possible that the dragon survived. And I just find out that he just kicks ass by killing each and every single range unit he can get his hands on. Also, the lifesteal here just came in handy. I've mentioned it a couple of times that this is a powerful ability for units, and I think here we can demonstrate that quite nicely. Each time he deals damage, he retrieves a bit of his health, and definitely against these lesser quality units, he can then recover a lot of his health before he dies off. Particularly against archers as well, because they don't counterattack, and each archer he kills is just basically him recovering his health. I get my Black Angel, which makes me very happy. I think I actually... Yeah, I go for casting specialist, I think. Maybe enchanters. Ah, yeah, okay. I want to save a bit of money on the enchanting. Contemplate building a shipyard. I almost never do build a shipyard. I don't think the ships are too useful, but I've been wrong before. I definitely need more mana income if I'm going to produce these Dark Angels at any considerable rate. So this is something I'm starting to focus on a little bit more now. Check what's going on with my ally. As it would look like the little run he had through the enemy territory, capturing all kinds of stuff, is now translating into the enemy trying to recapture everything he just captured from him. But it would appear our ally is applying more pressure. I definitely need to build up before my ally gets big. As I mentioned, I don't think this the settings of this game is with allied victory, which would mean that eventually I'm going to have to deal with my now ally. And by the time that happens, I want to be the stronger player. I definitely feel like I'm in a position to do just that, but there's still some things to do. Primarily building up a decent army. So, there goes my little army of flying units. I will keep him there to hunt for infidels should they appear. Here also a skimmer. I eventually decide to meet up these two armies, but for the time being there I keep them separate, so 3 skimmers here and 3 skimmers on the other side. of this mountain range, but as I mentioned, eventually they're going to be grouped up. I send my hero dragon to the army that I'm gathering at my Fedbasta City. I think that's what I called it. Decide to get rid of one of my my lava. It did us good, but unfortunately, this is not the perfect unit at this stage of the game. So I replaced most of the army with harvesters. This will be a very decent army if I can get it upgraded to, say, a gold rank or silver rank. Even might also help. Here I cast Darkland. It's one of my favorite spells. It's also one of the spells that makes me think of this game as one of the better ones. It helps with the immersion. What it does, it slowly kills off everything within my domain. And by that I don't necessarily mean the units, but the terrain. And this might not seem like a big deal, but there are definitely races who have great disadvantages to having cities inside of completely killed off terrain. For instance, the elves and all the good units cannot grow crops on killed land. So you basically make it impossible for your opponents to use a land they conquer, if they do so. This will of course hurt our economy, but aside from that, it's a very nice graphical thing as well. Your entire land, if you're evil, slowly but steadily turns into this decayed death. And I think it helps with immersion, and it's also a very nice thing if you ever get to the late game against the opposite alignment, so to say, because the good guys get a similar spell that turns everything very vividly and alive and forests and that kind of thing. So you can really have this life-death struggles going on in these games. Here I spot an army that I need to kill from my Spirit of Magic. It's an average these are average infidels, so I definitely need more than my three skimmers to deal with this. I also decide to make use of this this chance to level up some of my guys in this army that I've been building up slowly but steadily. The penguin is actually the most dangerous opponent in this army, which is quite hilarious actually. It has some very nice abilities, amongst which also lifesteal. The evil penguin. Amazing. Now, here I'm looking around to see what I can conquer. Of course, I'm going for this Orc City. It's quite an easy battle, but nevertheless, I think I do decide to do it myself, because I'm not entirely sure if the CPU... Oh no, I actually automatically do it. Okay, I don't lose anybody, so I suppose it works. That was a bit ballsy. Usually the CPU does not deal very well with these... self-destruct units that he had there. There was one unit that basically has a giant bomb on his back and explodes if he gets close enough. And if you don't deal with that properly, it can really, really damage your army. Yeah. Here I decide to get my hands on some dragons. Yeah. You can see me, the baby dragons. The baby dragons don't have a lot of health, but they do have rather nice stats. And if I can get them to the gold rank, they will turn into a full-blown dragon. And that could be very nice. I tried to do this in my last playthrough as well, but unfortunately I was unable to keep him alive. But this time I'm going to try and do things a little bit better. I'm going to give these dragons the enchantments they need to survive. And also I'm going to send a supporting army. And then also I have arenas nearby, so I can already get them to the silver rank before I get started. Which is of course nice. Now here I decide to auto-battle this fight. And unfortunately I lose one of my heroes doing so. Now this makes me of course very sad. Was one of my heroes dead? But yeah, for the people who saw my last Let's Play, this is not a surprise at all that I lose one of my heroes. To be honest, I'm quite amazed that he lived as long as he did. But with a little bit of luck, I might actually be able to revive him if I ever do the animate hero research. Decide to switch out and send this blade to one of my my other heroes. Optimize our effectiveness with these items. They can definitely give some very big boosts, so it's worth optimizing this. You can actually also late game make your own items.
This can be very, very useful, but yeah. It's also quite expensive and definitely late game stuff. We've not quite reached it, that point. Should probably also be slowing down my research. I've got the majority of the stuff that I want. I definitely don't need an enormous amount more of the what I can research. So the things I can still research are not that useful. That's what I guess I'm saying. Here I look at what I'm going to give my hero. I wisely decide to give him health and hopefully make him endure a little longer than he otherwise would have. After all, he's on his own now, as far as being a hero is concerned. Now I've got a full army here. I might actually be... I don't know if I do this now, or that I just plan to do this, but I do eventually want to switch out these stack mounts with other units as well. Oh, that is a loud beep. What's causing the beep? Well, hope you're not too annoyed by this. Hope you cannot hear it. Ah, it stopped. Okay, excellent. Some car just randomly decided to get his alarm to go off. Hopefully you weren't bothered by it too much. Oh man. Definitely not going to record anything more today. Let's get some tea. Get some rest. That would be a good idea, I think. Yep, there we go. Now, funnily enough, I brought these skimmers closer to help with the battle and then decide not to use them. Which is typical. I think here I also figure out that it's probably a nice idea to get rid of these skimmers. Or the skimmers, get rid of these stag mounts. They're really not that useful anymore. I am really happy with this hero, though. It's not often you get a hero that from the start already has archery, or something like it. And yeah, it can be useful to have a hero that also has ranged attacks. Now you can see I'm slowly but steadily swallowing armies with my my group of harvesters. And after the battle you'll see that not only do we spawn units in-game, or in battle, they also do so after battle. So if you've swallowed three units with these harvesters, here we go. Or not. We'll see, maybe probably next turn then. Yes, okay. And now I'm swallowing him. No, swallow him. There you go. And now you can actually see he spawned three little larvae, which is amazing. This is such a useful ability, and it's also unique, I think, to the Shadow Demons. Only the Harvester is capable of doing this. But it definitely works. Here, the floating armor. I find this very useful, because if you remember, up top I have this one army, which used to have two heroes, but thanks to my boldness, I lost one of these. And this floating armor... this army now only contains flying units and my hero. If I then give this army also, or this hero also, this floating armor, he is effectively flying. So I can use this army as if it were all flying units, so it could float over lakes, over mountains. It makes it a lot more mobile, and I definitely think this would be a game. Recruit the next dragon. And I sent this dragon up. I do remember seeing Rina here. I did. So there's where the baby dragons are going. Going to give them a few enchantments, but I don't actually think this will be addressed in this episode. Perhaps the next one. We'll see. I definitely want to use the city as well to expand my domain. Get a nice large domain going, where of course everything will be killed in, but that aside, it will also give me a large domain in which to cast spells and such and such. This is useful of course for summoning units, but it's also quite useful for protecting my land should it be attacked. As long as they're in my domain, I can use spells to damage these incoming armies. You can already see that patches of the area are dying off. Which is definitely something I'm happy about. Okay, next turn. Come on. Oh, no, I choose not to, apparently. Oh yeah, here I actually figure out that maybe it's a good idea to have this army being floating. Yes. Okay, so now I switch out this floating armor. Then I, yeah, here I'm showing it. Now they're all flying. You can also see it in the icon below. Now the real question is, does he already have armor? He surely does. And this I then teleport to the last remaining hero I have, I think, who doesn't have any armor. Which is our main guy, or main girl, I should say. Ling game. Why did I decide to go for that? No, anyway, doesn't matter. I did lose a bit of stats because I changed out the armor, so this is something I need to keep keep an eye on when I go into battle, of course, but also with the upgrades. So if I can get some resistance from one of my level ups, it's definitely something I should do. And my first Black Angel is ready to cast. And I, of course, cast in the army who is one short. Okay, migrated to Dark Elves, this makes me happy. Get a wooden wall around it and build some arches. Don't know if I mentioned this already, but these arches of the Dark Elves actually have... I think it's accuracy? No, it has a different name. Anyway, their ranged attacks are boosted, so they have more damage and more likely to hit. This will make them infinitely more useful when they're first introduced, and also it means that once they level up, they are just the better archer. And this also makes them very useful for defense. So defending cities with these Dark Elves is a little bit easier than it would be for certain other races. I don't think I actually go for the library here. I think I figured this out. I go for the Wizard Tower instead. Okay. I thought I would do this in Fat Bastard City or Fat Bastard Town. I don't remember. Should check. Okay, well, still building up force, of course, but we are slowly but steadily getting to a point where I'm very dangerous indeed. I have here this army near Fat Bastard Town, Fat Bastard City, whatever it is, and I've got that army there, which is now looking quite frightening. Maybe I'll buy the upgrades for it, but everything put together, this would be quite expensive. I think it would cost me about 800 gold to get this to work. I initially tried to upgrade these lava, but then I decided it's probably not really worth the cost. Should spend this money on something more useful. We do have a very powerful economy now. You can see I earn 500 gold a turn. This will, once I stop building upgrades in my cities, mean that I can really start cramming out units like a madman. Also, these units I could then upgrade in the... Yeah, in the the arena, the silver rank, which is of course very very useful. It boosts the stats and all kinds of good stuff, as I mentioned before. Ooh, close call. He is also scouting out my opponent's map. This red opponent, but what I don't know yet is there's actually quite a large army approaching this city. I don't know if I figured this out now or later, but I definitely do figure it out this episode. I remember seeing this. The Scrubicus, very useful abilities, but a bit lower health. You can see it has Seduce, which is very useful. I'll show this in battle at one point. Life Stealing, which is of course useful. Flying, which is of course also very useful. True Seeing, not so much. Concealment is not that big of an issue in our current matchup, I think. But all in all, it could be a very useful unit. Maybe it gets a health boost from its upgrades, so it's silver and gold rank medals. We'll see. Decide to keep the army of skimmers there, a bit in the middle, so I can send them wherever I want to. Not sure what to do with that army yet. Probably going to send it up to help in the offensive against Red. It's a very formidable army at this point, and I should be using it. Power leak, decide to research that. I've not had the realization yet that perhaps animating heroes would be a good idea. Normally I ignore this because of the different alignment of these heroes. These heroes will probably not even choose to join you, and they will instead start attacking you, so it's it's not really the ideal circumstance. Consider building a wizard tower there, but eventually decide that it's a bad idea. Still need to build the sanctuary there, and if I do build the sanctuary there, I can then get access to the most powerful unit the Shadow Demons can make in their cities. And it truly is a very, very powerful unit. I think it's one of the most powerful units in the game, actually. So I'm very excited to get my hands on these units. Yeah. And start wrecking some enemies. Yeah. Get my second Scrubbuckers here. Just going to recruit an army with gold. And send it to assist my dragons. They're adorable, I must say. Hopefully they'll grow up to be nice, big and powerful dragons we can use for the army, but... oh, they're so cute. I cannot help but indulge myself in trying to make them big and strong and interesting. I forget that there's actually an army there. This will probably actually be my first target for the... my first target for my dragons and my Scrubbuckers, so we'll see how that goes. Might just include the Shade into that army, but I'm not sure yet. If I do so, they no longer an entire army of flying, which is a disadvantage on its own. Okay, let's see how much time do we still have left. Oh, we have a little bit more time, okay. So here I find out that, or I try to upgrade as many of my my harvesters and brains and whatever. Yes, upgrade. There we go. It cost a lot of money, but now this army is truly terrifying. They've all got their attack, damage, whatever, already upgraded. They have a lot of health, actually, I'm now seeing. What is that, 28 health? 27? Anyway, a lot of health. They're also, because of the brain has an ability called leadership. This boosts the stat a little of every single unit in the army they're in. It's usually an ability I go for in my heroes as well, but I don't actually need it this time because I can have access to these brains, which by themselves are also a very good tank for magic abilities, and they can float over walls, which is of course also nice. They're not that dangerous for the direct attack, but then they are one of the last units you build as the Shadow Demons, which makes them also it basically means they cannot be super shitty. It's practically impossible. Do I just decide to build a Hall of Darkness there? I don't actually think this is a too useful building. I mean, sure, if you're on the defense it can be useful, but only when your opponent is good. And our main opponent right now is evil, so that's not really, really a useful thing. I think he actually gets the same boost we do then, so it might even be a bad thing. I get a nice boost for my dragons here. They're adorable as ever. I think they actually got a little health boost as well. Just 1 HP, but, you know, 1 HP on 10 HP is still 10%, so, hey. Not complaining. Survivability for my adorable little dragons. Get Scrubbuckers upgraded as well. Ah, yeah, I'm going to check what's available for buying there. I do go for the Doombats. Because the Doombats also have lifesteal, they don't have a lot of health, but they can definitely be annoying. Yeah. Not sure though, did I do that? Or did I just think about doing it? I definitely need more army. This is the truth, if there ever was one. They're not super duper happy with me, these baby dragons. They're well aware that I'm evil and they're more of a neutral kind, these baby dragons. But with a little bit of luck, they either turn into a black dragon or a bone dragon, which is quite powerful. I know I can summon these bone dragons, but come on, I raised them all myself, these baby dragons. And the black dragon is, I think, a joint first place in the most powerful unit in the game with the golden dragon. Which would be the good equivalent of the black dragon. The black dragon is pure evil, the golden dragon is pure good. I get another quest. Oh, they asked me to. Oh, yeah, this was incredibly fun. I see that a hard quest, which is generally very hard, to capture something in enemy territory, which tells me there's a humongous army sitting on top of it. But yeah, here is the humongous army. It's mostly made up of shit, as I mentioned earlier, so my harvesters will definitely come in useful here. But yeah, this little area that the spirit asked to capture is actually undefended, so I can just sneak in and get it and get my reward from the Spirit of Magic, and yeah, subsequently get the reward for it, which is of course nice. Here I'm contemplating what to build. I go for a war hall, apparently. Okay. Suppose this works. More mana income with the monastery. Yes, this is what I'm trying to get to. This will be next turn, though. My Black Angel is pretty much beast mode at this point, so I'm not too worried about this army here. There's a few archers, don't get me wrong, but the majority of it is definitely not, and I have too much air for them to be a real threat to me. Definitely this Black Angel, it will probably cut through several armies before they encounter anything with too much difficulty. The real question is, would my hero survive? This is always a good question to ask. And here is the Chaos Lord, which is an evil unit, and it has a lot of attack, a lot of damage. It might actually be the most damaging unit in the game, now that I think about it, because it has double strike. So for each attack, normally it has three, but these Chaos Lords, for each attack it doubles it. So instead of attacking once, then the enemy attacking, then attacking again, it attacks twice, then the enemy gets a chance to counterattack, then you again attack twice, such on and so forth. Could be a very useful unit. Here I finally get the right idea and build my wizard tower in Fat Bastard City. I definitely going to get some defenses in there. Going to need it. Not going to save up on protecting that city. It's too valuable for us. There I see this city, this node is captured, and I retreat back to my life node, or my air node, that I was protecting earlier on. Not sure if I am going to try and defend that life, or that life node. Why do I keep saying life node? That air node. I'm not sure if I'm going to do this. It is quite a large army, and though my army is, from a qualitative point of view, much, much better, it is quite a large army that's attacking me, and I'm not sure if I can do it with acceptable losses. Maybe if I get my army of harvesters up there as well, then maybe I can deal with it. Soon though, I should be able to go to the offensive. This is a good thing. I mean, building up army is fine and dandy and all, but you don't watch me for my economic upgrading ability. I don't think, at least. Anyway, here I'm for a final time checking all my cities to see what I can do. But this is pretty much the end of this episode. I hope you enjoyed this somewhat longer episode than normal. A whole 44 minutes and then some. So yeah, don't expect this to be standard. It was a little bit of a mistake by me. But yeah, if you did enjoy this episode, please leave a like. And yeah, I'll see you next time. Enjoy the last little bit of footage of me derping around my Let's Play here. Hope you enjoyed.